Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination, and you are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
But remember, the risk of cheating the plan, of disrespecting the design, could incite a fury that could terrorize even the Grim Reaper. And you don't even want to fuck with that Mac Daddy.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Seib, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, Bree, and Bonanza Jellybean. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel, and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select, such as the $2 tier gets you the early access content, the $5 tier gets you the early access plus a free ebook emailed to you every 3 months, and every 12 months you get a free gift from the merch store. There's also a $15 tier that gets you a free gift from the merch store every 6 months, a free ebook every 3 months, and you can appear on the podcast and voice a character in an audiobook narration once per month. So there's many choices to choose from. Just click the Patreon link in the description below and check it out. There's even a mega tier that comes with a lot more stuff. And enjoy tonight's upload of Final Destination Dead Reckoning. Final Destination Dead Reckoning. Chapter 12. Macy looked up to see a blur of movement coming towards her. Her eyes widened, and the next thing she knew, she was plunging sideways onto the booth seat as Jamie grabbed her in a flying football tackle, pulling her out of the way of the falling sign. She lay there for a moment, then her head jerked up. She pushed Jamie off her in one quick movement, then stared behind her in fear as the sign twitched and jerked on the seat. There was a strong smell of ozone and burning vinyl. Then the seat started to smoke. Macy scrambled away from it with a cry. The restaurant manager darted forwards and snatched up a broom from the corner, then used it to pull the sign's plug out of the electrical outlet. The sign buzzed once, then dimmed to a dull glow. "I think we'll be leaving now," said Jess to the manager. She extended a hand to the prone Macy. "Come on, girl, let's get you out of here." The five of them left the diner in silence, watched by everyone in the place. When they got outside, Eric turned to Jess. "Nice show," he said nastily. "You almost had me convinced there."
"I'm not trying to convince you of anything," snapped Jess, still wound up. "I was nowhere near that waiter."
"Yeah, but it was your..."
"Look, okay, I don't care what you think. When will you get that through your tiny little brain?"
"Guys, that's enough," said Jamie. "Look at what you've done to Macy."
All four of them turned to look. Macy was standing a little distance away from them outside, by a nearby gun shop, leaning on a parked car by the busy road. She looked as if she were about to throw up. She noticed them looking at her and gave a weak little smile, which faded almost immediately.
Puffing himself up, Eric whipped off his jacket and sauntered over to Macy, wrapping it around her shoulders to keep her warm. He leaned back on a big sign that read in big letters, "We Buy Guns," and gave Jess a smug glance.
"Yeah, look at what you've done. You've traumatized the poor wee girl."
"I was talking to both of you," said Jamie. "You're acting like a pair of school kids. Get over it and go home, Macy," he said more gently. "I'm taking you home. We'll get a cab." He reached into his pocket for his wallet. Macy shook her head fearfully.
"No, thanks. Eric will take me, won't you?"
Jess glanced at Jamie, then back at Macy. She raised an eyebrow.
"I sure will, little lady. You'll be safe with me."
Eric glanced up at Ben, who turned away from the others and gave him a big thumbs up, then made a less polite gesture with his other hand.
"Like hell you will. Macy, come here. We will drive you back."
"Yeah, and maybe Jess will see to it that your door isn't shut properly. Then she'll take a lot of sharp corners, then she'll be right," said Eric. "I wouldn't put it past her," he added smugly.
"If that's what you think, then you're on your own," said Jess. "At least Ben's on my side." She swung around. "Right, Ben?"
Ben held up his hands. "Don't look at me, lassie. I'm just here for the food, folks," he said.
"Come on, you've got to have some kind of opinion."
"Nope. Leave me out of it, please."
"Tell you what," Macy walked over to the group. "I'll make my own way home. I can't deal with all of this right now."
She pulled a pack of chewing gum out of her pocket and absent-mindedly unwrapped a stick, then froze with it halfway to her mouth. She took a few careful breaths, then wrapped it back up again.
"I gotta get some sleep. I'll see you all around. Good night."
She turned her back on them and started walking towards the cab rank. This time, they all yelled,
"Macy!"
Macy jumped back as a dreadlocked cyclist whizzed past her on the unlit sidewalk. The metal-tipped surfboard strapped to his side pointed right at her. She stood there for a long moment, gazing after the cyclist had sped off into the night and traffic whizzed by. Then she turned round and walked back to Jess.
"So," she said brightly, "where's this car of yours, then?"
They walked back across the sprawling parking lot in silence, lost in their own individual thoughts. Jess dropped back slightly and walked beside Jamie, who was bringing up the rear.
"So how's it going with you?" she asked.
"Me? I'm good. Doom, gloom, death, and destruction. Same old, you know. Do you want a tic-tac?"
"No, thanks."
Jess glanced up at him anxiously. There had been no signs warning her of Macy's near misses in the diner.
"What do you think about what I said?" she asked.
"I don't know, Jess. I want to believe you, but you know me. Healthy skepticism and all that. But I'll be careful all the same."
"Good man."
They walked past a motorcyclist who was refueling his huge Harley from a can under the light of a street lamp. The driver glanced up and glared at them as they walked by. He wore a lettered biker jacket and had a dramatic scar running down one side of his jaw. They gave him a wide berth. Jess glanced sideways at Jamie.
"So, what was up with you and Macy tonight?" she asked.
"Hmm?"
"I thought I detected a bit of an atmosphere back there."
"You think?"
"Well, yeah, she hardly said two words to you. I thought you guys got on pretty good."
"We do."
Jamie shoved his hands into his pockets and picked up his pace. Jess gave a sigh.
"You're not exactly helping me out here. Is there something you want to tell me?"
"No. Why should there be?"
"You tell me."
They walked a little further on. Jamie glanced at Jess, opened his mouth as if to say something, then closed it again.
"Yes?" said Jess, not unkindly.
"It's just that..."
Jamie swigged from his packet of Tic Tacs, crunching distractedly. He lowered his voice, sounding embarrassed.
"I think she kind of has a thing for me."
"So, what does that prove? She's not blind," said Jess.
She dug Jamie in the ribs with an elbow, raising her eyebrows.
"She saw you play, right?"
"Yeah, I guess. She was at the gig last Monday, too, and, the one this weekend before that at the joint. Right at the front, too."
Well, well, well. Looks like you've got yourself a bit of a fan. Oh, it must be hard being so irresistible.
I wouldn't know, said Jamie, a little more sharply than he'd intended. He looked around him, then dropped his voice still further, moving closer to Jess as they walked. And it's not just that. There was an incident.
Oh, yeah? Jess grinned. Do tell.
Not that kind of incident.
Pity. Go on.
Well, it was that night we were all at the police station after, you know.
I do. What happened?
After you guys left, the cops took me back to the station and...
They caught you? Jess stopped walking. I thought you got away.
Yeah, Jamie sniffed. So did I. Must be getting slow in my old age. Anyway, Macy came by the station and bailed me out, then took me back to her place for the night.
That was nice of her.
A thought struck Jess as she started walking after the others.
Why didn't you tell me this?
You never asked.
Jamie kicked a stone across the parking lot, which rebounded off the tire of a parked scooter.
So anyway, he continued, I didn't really want to go back with her, but...
He glanced ahead of them at the others and put a hand on Jess's arm.
Walk slower.
That bad, eh? Said Jess.
I've had worse, so anyway, I knew she liked me, so naturally I was a bit apprehensive about going back with her. Turns out I was right. She talks my ear off all the way home, then when we get there she tells me that, oops, all the spare bedding's in the wash because her cat's peed on it, and there's no sofa, so would I mind sharing a bed with her?
You're kidding! That's so obvious.
Tell me about it. I nearly turned round and walked out of the place, but I was just so tired, you know. Anyway, it luckily turns out to be a double bed, but it might as well not have been, because now, oops, her nightgown's in the wash, too. What a shame, and she's telling me that she always likes to lie slap-bang in the middle of the bed in case she falls out. I think you're getting the picture now, right?
Loud and clear, said Jess, then she stopped again.
Hold on, she said to Jamie.
Eric! She yelled.
What?
Where the hell are you parked?
Over there!
Eric pointed to a big black SUV parked in the far corner of the crowded lot.
Geez, okay, go on. So you're in bed with this hot naked girl, and you have a problem. Why?
Of course I have a problem. I hardly even know the girl, and now she's getting all up close and personal with me, so... I try to sleep, but every time I roll over, she's right up in my face, like this.
Jamie skipped ahead of Jess and pushed his face right up against hers, grinning maniacally. Jess stopped walking and grabbed Jamie by the shoulders, pushing him away. She laughed nervously.
All right, I get the picture. Again, you have a problem with this?
Sure I do. So after a while, I got out of bed, pretending to need the bathroom. Then grabbed my clothes and legged it out the front door. I couldn't deal with her. I just needed to sleep. She hasn't spoken to me since.
Jess giggled.
I can't believe you bailed on Macy.
Neither could she. Hence the not speaking to me thing.
But you're a guy. Guys aren't supposed to do that.
Why do you always say that, Jesse? You say it like it's some kind of insult. So I'm a guy. So what? Does that automatically mean I have no standards of behavior?
Some would say that's true.
Jamie reached out and tapped Jess gently on the nose.
Then some must have a very low opinion of us guys.
Not low, just realistic.
Only if you date the kind of men you date, Jess.
Jess's expression froze on her face.
What's that supposed to mean?
Come on, Jess.
Jamie's face indicated that he knew he was playing with fire, but he went on.
What about that doctor guy? The one that turned out to have two other lady friends as well as a wife and a kid. And then there was that whole football guy drama, and then the acrobat from the Russian state circus, not to mention the lifeguard you spent all last month chasing after.
Jamie cupped his hands around his mouth, megaphone style.
Hello, Houston. Calling Jessica. Your time is up. Come back in, please.
It's none of your damn business who I date.
Jess tried to walk around Jamie, but he stood in her way.
Move!
No.
Jamie dropped his voice.
You need to take a reality check, girl, or someone's going to end up getting hurt. Most likely you. There are some bad people out there, and I worry about you.
Since when do you care?
Jess stopped as she saw the look in Jamie's eyes.
Oh, no, not this again.
Come on, Jess, you know I'm making sense.
Jamie moved towards her,
reaching out to cup her face, but Jess took a firm step away from him.
"Hey, don't be like that," Jamie said, looking hurt. "I only want what's best for you."
"No, you don't. You want... I don't even know what you think about what you want." Jess shook her head firmly. "Jamie, you've got to stop doing this, because it's freaking me out."
"Doing what?" "Jess, I'm not doing anything."
"Yes, you are. You've been like this ever since we..."
Jess hesitated.
"Since what?" asked Jamie.
"Go on. You can say it. I don't mind. Ever since we..."
"Guys, come on! Jeez!" yelled Eric from over by the SUV.
"Coming!" Jess called back, secretly glad of the reprieve. She turned and looked up at Jamie, her face softening.
"Look, Jamie..."
She took hold of his hands.
"I really like you. You know that, don't you? You're such a..."
"Nice guy, I know," said Jamie tiredly.
He pulled his hands away from Jess and shoved them back into his pockets.
"Charlie told me all about that."
"What's Charlie got to do with anything?"
"He said you told him about us."
Jess was silent for a heartbeat, then she shrugged.
"All I said was..."
"It's not important. I don't care what you tell people. The only thing that matters to me is that you take care of yourself, and I don't think you're doing that at the moment."
"So that's your professional opinion, is it?"
"It is."
"Then your opinion sucks."
Jess pushed past Jamie, but he grabbed her shoulder and held on tight.
"Jess, listen to me. All this stuff since the club disaster, like you hanging around with Charlie, it's just another symptom. You like to feel important, I get that, I'm cool with it. But at what price? I think you're just going to end up getting hurt all over again, and next time, maybe I won't be there to bail you out."
In reply, Jess pointedly tugged her shoulder free of Jamie's grip and turned her back on him, heading over to the SUV.
"I'm heading home," she said coldly. "You want a ride? Then hurry up, because it's late and I'm tired."
Jamie watched her go and gave a deep sigh. He looked over at the SUV as Eric started unlocking the door. Something immediately caught his attention. Was it just him, or had someone just ducked behind the car? Instantly, on full alert, he ran over to the SUV, waving his hands.
"Guys, wait!" he hissed.
"It's all right. We're not going to go without you," said Jess, leaning on the door of the car while Eric struggled with his keys.
"No, behind the car!" Jamie pointed. "I think there's someone there."
"What? Where?"
Eric marched around the front of the SUV.
"Hey!"
he yelled. Around the other side, a homeless guy was busy levering one of the chromed hubcaps off the rear wheel. Seeing Eric, he dropped his tire iron with a clang, backing away quickly. Standing up, he held the freshly removed hubcap out to Eric like a begging bowl.
"Spare any change, buddy?"
he asked with a toothless grin.
"No, I damn well cannot, and give me that back!"
Eric made a grab for the hubcap. The homeless guy whipped it away from him and hid it inside his tasseled jacket.
"Sorry, gone now."
Eric started forwards, fist raised, then stopped. His eyebrows did a complicated dance.
"Wait a minute. I know you. You're the guy from the other night."
"Yes, man from many nights." The man nodded his head sagely. His supply of relevant conversation exhausted, Eric raised his fist again.
"Whatever, give me back my hubcap."
"Eric, leave him alone, mate."
"Do you know how much these things cost?"
"Ask him nicely for it back then."
"What's going on?"
Jess ducked her head around the edge of the car. Her jaw dropped.
"You,"
she said.
"Me," agreed the cowboy.
"I can't believe you're here. You have no idea how badly I need to talk to you."
"No talk. Gotta go. Mother's expecting me," said the cowboy urgently.
He swept a hand upwards at the sky.
"Well, at least it's good to see that he's still got his sanity."
"Eric, shut your mouth. Now I really have to ask you..."
"Sorry. Time to split," said the cowboy. He gave Macy a strange look, then scurried off towards the back gate.
"Hey, come back!"
Jess thumped Eric.
"Go after him. I need to talk to him."
"Why are you so weird? Seriously, like, I never met anyone as weird as you."
"Just go, get him back."
"Screw you, you go get him yourself."
"But he's got your hubcap."
"Oh yeah." Eric's face darkened. "Hey, come back here."
He ducked into the SUV and grabbed a flashlight. Then he set off across the edge of the parking lot, chasing the rapidly diminishing figure of the cowboy, who vanished down a side alley with a whoop of glee. Jess tore off her jacket.
"Stay here, guys."
Jamie bristled. "No way. I'm not letting you go off in the dark with that jerk."
"Come with us, then," Jess said.
"But move it!"
"That woman, ish," said Jamie, stamping his foot.
He threw an apologetic look towards Macy and Ben.
"Guard the car, children. Back in a minute."
Macy watched him run off, then turned and looked at Ben. Ben nodded at her amiably, a huge grin plastered across his face.
"How you doing, lassie?" he said.
Macy glanced worriedly around her at the busy darkness, then looked back at the diminutive figure of Ben, who gave her a big wink. She did a swift mental calculation.
"Hey, you guys," she yelled. "Wait up!"
She began trotting off after them as fast as her heels would allow. Within a minute, she disappeared down the alley.
"Well, what cheek?" said Ben.
A few minutes strolled by. He inspected his nails under the glare of an orange light from a street lamp, then polished them on his jacket. He threw a glance at the alleyway, debating whether or not to go after Macy, then realized that Eric had left the car unlocked. That meant he was stuck here until they got back. Well, that really was too much. Why was it always him left holding the baby, so to speak? They didn't even think that he might have wanted to go along. Oh, no. They'd just gone off and left him. The splitters. Did they not think that he could help? He may not have had Eric's looks or Jamie's deep voice, whatever Jamie had, but he could still make himself useful in some small way. He was a man, after all. Ben puffed himself up to his full 5'6" height and moodily kicked the SUV's rubber tire with his boot. Stupid car! It wasn't that he particularly wanted to go running off on some wild goose chase, no. It was just the principle of the thing. They'd automatically assumed he'd look after the car, and they'd all gone off and left him. There was action to be had, and he was missing it. He was so sick of everyone taking him for granted. Ben slammed the car door with considerably more force than was needed, then leaned back on it grumpily, listening to the sounds of the night. Besides the ever-present background hum of traffic, he could hear dozens of voices talking, laughing, singing. It was past midnight, but out here on the strip, things were just warming up for the night. A faint rhythmic thumping came from a nearby club, the occasional blast of guitar noise spilling out onto the street as people went in and out. The scratchy sound of a radio came from the valet parking booth on the corner, and the roar of motorcycle engines echoed down the street in the distance. Somewhere in the parking lot, a bottle shattered. Ben's ears pricked up. A bottle? Then he leaned forward, squinting into the darkness. Was it his imagination, or had someone just followed Macy into the alleyway? He peered closer, then shrank back as a group of dark shapes flitted towards the mouth of the alley and vanished inside. That was a lot of someones. Ben tensed, his heartbeat speeding up. He was sure those people were up to no good. He should go warn the guys just in case. But who would look after the car? He stole a guilty glance at it. It was brand new and presumably very expensive. Eric would beat the living shit out of him if anything happened to it. But on the other hand, if his friends were in danger, aw, to hell with it. Ben reached inside his jacket, checking that something was still there. There was a faint click, and he withdrew his hand, closing up his jacket carefully. Maybe he could be of some use tonight after all. Throwing an anxious look back at the SUV, Ben ran off towards the alley, after his friends.
"He's gone! How could he be gone? He just vanished!"
"People don't just vanish, doofus. Check behind that car over there."
"I just looked. He's definitely gone."
Jess put her hands on her hips and peered around her, screwing up her eyes in the gloom. It was dark down the alley, and it smelled bad. A row of parked cars huddled against a building to one side of the road, which was covered in tatty builder's scaffolding and wooden boarding. A huge sight safety sign hung loosely from a wire on the scaffold. There was definitely no sign of the homeless guy anywhere.
"Perhaps he went the other way. He can't have gone far."
"He'd better not have. Those hubcaps cost a fortune."
"Look, would you forget about that freaking hubcap? There's more important things at stake here."
Eric snorted. Yeah, like your sad little reputation. I'll send out the funeral invites right now, shall I?
Look, over there by the wall, something moved.
That was my shadow. You need some sleep, girl.
Jamie skidded around the corner and jogged over to Jess.
What's happening?
He asked, throwing a sharp glance at Eric.
Is your guy here?
Nah, he ran off, said Jess, looking glum. He came around the corner, but he's not in the street. It's really weird. We looked both ways.
Maybe he's hiding. I would at this hour.
I doubt it, said Eric gloomily. We checked under all the cars, and that scaffolding's too high to climb. A thought struck him. Maybe he went down into the sewers.
He shone his flashlight downwards at the nearest manhole, then bent down and tried to open it.
This is real life, dickwad. People don't go down into the sewers like they do on TV. They're all locked up.
Jamie glanced around him anxiously.
Come on, guys, we should get going. It's dark. It's not safe to be around here.
We're fine, said Jess icily. You don't have to chaperone us. Go back to the car. We'll be back in 5 minutes.
I'm not leaving you. Already said that. I don't think this is a good place to go wandering around in the dark.
And what would you know, seriously, dude? Said Eric nastily.
More than you, if nothing else. You stand out a mile in that white collar of yours. You're practically glowing. You may as well paint a bullseye on your head and put that manhole cover back. You're not impressing anyone.
I wasn't locked, liar, and... Anyway, I was just trying to help.
Then don't. Just come back to the parking lot, both of you. I'll stay and look around here.
Jamie paused, listening, then went on.
He can't have gone far, and even if he did, he can't keep running. I'll find him, if it's so important to you. A person can't just vanish.
Wanna bet?
Eric glanced up sharply to see a scruffy, wiry man step out of the alleyway into the light. He had long, matted dreadlocks and wore a tattered raincoat with expensive-looking trainers. He had a skateboard strapped to his back. He was holding Macy by the throat.
What the?
Eric's eyes narrowed and he swung around towards Jess.
Is this your idea of a joke?
Funny you folks should be walking around here like this time of night, said the man, in a conversational tone. He examined Macy's earrings with his free hand. Normally visitors to these parts don't stop by.
Macy gave a small gasp, and Eric thought he saw something metallic flash under the streetlights. He's got a knife, he thought. Shit. Out loud, he said,
We were just looking for someone, but now we're leaving, weren't we, guys?
He glanced to both sides. Jess's face was ashen, her eyes locked on Macy. Jamie was staring fixedly at the man, his entire body tense. He saw them glance at one another meaningfully, and then slowly began to edge apart. He looked back at the man, noticing how white and new-looking his trainers were compared to the rest of his outfit, which looked like it had been washed in a sewer. However, skateboard guy continued, he gave a nasty little smile, revealing gold-capped teeth. I would be willing to help you find your way back home again. Kinda like a public service. That's me. These streets can get very dangerous after nightfall. Spectacularly so, in fact. He looked down at Macy, who was holding herself very still in his grasp, and sniffed, screwing up his face. Course I'd need some kind of funding for that to happen. He wiped his nose on a coat sleeve.
We don't have any money on us, said Eric, puffing himself up.
Out of the corner of his eye, he saw Jamie shake his head frantically.
Course you do. I just saw you come out the fucking food hall, for Christ's sakes. Give me some credit. I ain't blind.
The man straightened up, his eyes glinting.
I figure that at least one of you got some collateral on you. You dog boy.
He jerked his elbow at Eric.
Roll up your sleeves.
What? Why? He wants your watch, dude, said Jamie in a monotone.
His lips barely moved as he spoke.
Might be best to give it to him. You've got to be kidding me. Do you know how much this thing cost? Me? Oh, damn!
The skateboard man sniggered and stepped forward.
New around here, is he?
In a manner of speaking, yes, said Jamie.
His eyes still hadn't left the man's face.
Come on now, as soon as we get this over and done with, sooner we can all be on our merry ways.
Just do it, Eric, Jamie said. But my dad gave it to me for my birthday. It's brand new.
Then your dad's gonna get you another one, isn't he? Said the man. He yanked Macy backwards, making her yelp. Come on, hurry up, or your little girlfriend loses a bit off her, and you ain't choosing which bit.
He's got a watch, too, whined Eric, nodding his head over at Jamie. Take his instead.
Eric. Great, I'll have that, too, thank you.
Skateboard man increased his grip on Macy's throat, making her wheeze.
Quickly, please, kiddies, and you too, drama queen. Turn out your pockets.
Relenting under the heat of Jess's glare, Eric reached up his sleeve and fiddled with the catch on his gold Rolex, muttering to himself. Behind him, Jamie slid off his own battered surf watch and tossed it down in front of the man, giving Eric a black look. Jess reached into her jean pockets and threw a handful of $1 bills down with it. She stepped back expectantly.
And your bra.
Excuse me?
You got anything hidden in that bra of yours? Credit cards and so on? Come on, you looks like the sort. Don't make me come over there and check.
I have nothing of the kind.
Suit yourself, but you realize there's a no-card fee on this particular transaction.
There was another glint of metal in the darkness, and Macy yelled,
Jess! All right, fine, take it.
Jess reached inside her top and pulled out a battered debit card. Scowling, she hurled it down onto the pile.
Pleasure doing business with you folks, said the skateboard man, eyeing the pile with satisfaction. Now, if you would be so kind as to back off and...
Don't you move!
The man's scarred eyebrows drew together and he glanced backwards towards the alleyway. There was some short, scared-looking kid standing behind him, both arms raised and pointed right at the small of his back. He couldn't see what the kid was clutching on account of him being so close, but after what he'd just said, there was only one or two things he could be holding. Judging by the stunned looks on his friends' faces, it was option two. He sighed.
Drop it, kid.
No way. Let her go.
The skateboard man smirked to himself and mentally counted to three, hearing clothing rustle and gravel crunch in the alleyway behind him. Then he tightened his grip on the girl and turned around. He nodded amiably to the five other guys who had just stepped out of the shadows behind the kid. They didn't just stand there. They loomed. There was the general crossing of arms and stamping of boots that somehow managed to convey that the newcomers were armed. One of the guys peered closely at the brand name of the gun Ben was holding and laughed derisively. In his arms, the girl started to cry. Sweating, Ben jerked his gun up even higher, the tip weaving crazily from side to side.
Tell them to back off? Tell them to back off now?
What makes you think that they're with me? Perhaps they're just out here for an afternoon stroll. Lovely weather we've been having lately.
Ben, put that fucking thing down now, shouted Jamie.
Yeah, Ben, said skateboard guy. Guns is dangerous things, you know. They just make things worse. Might put someone's eye out with that thing if you're not careful. Most likely your own.
Just let her go, arsehole.
And why should I do that? Things just got interesting. Matter-of-factly, I think I'll grab hold of that other girl over there, see what else you've got up your sleeve.
Skateboard guy tittered to himself.
Don't you dare go near her!
Ben spat. He jerked his head at Jamie.
He's got a knife. He'll slash the shit out of you if you ever think about touching her.
All eyes turned to Jamie, inspecting him with interest. The temperature in the alley seemed to drop by several degrees.
Thanks, Ben, Jamie managed, and nicely put.
He got ready to run.
Well, more and more interesting, it seems.
Ben, for the love of God, stop jerking around and put the gun down, snapped Eric.
No way, he lets her go first.
And then what, we all go and have a drink and a laugh together? Ben, you're an asshole, we were doing just fine till you showed up.
Yeah, looks like you had everything under control.
Ben laughed bitterly, unable to help himself.
Oh, and I'm the arsehole now, am I? I'm not the one who nearly gets himself killed for the sake of a few pounds of drugs, eh, Eric?
Eric's mouth dropped open. His hand flew to the brace collar around his neck.
How did you know?
Dude, I'm not stupid. You've been doing it ever since I first met you. Same thing every time. It's so damn obvious it makes me want to cry.
You never said...
Sure, I never said. I was too busy enjoying the free food and drinks you've been pouring down my throat since I got here last year. Need someone to watch the door? Get old Ben in and set him up with a beer or two. What a quiet place to deal. Call Ben and get him to rent a room under his name, just in case. Ben gripped the gun tighter. Why do you think I got this gun in the first place? You think I sleep well at night knowing you're downstairs trading God knows what with some hoods from the projects? They know where we live, dude.
I'll have to give you my number, said the skateboard guy, impressed.
Shut the fuck up or I'll waste you now, snapped Ben. He turned back to Eric, ignoring the sudden warning atmosphere from the guys behind him. I've had it up to here with you using me. You think it was a coincidence that chick cop was at the club Friday night?
Eric stared at Ben. Slowly, he raised his finger and pointed. You were the one who called the cops on us? I lost $800 that night, besides everything else. It took me weeks to set that deal up.
I didn't want to do it, said Ben, his voice starting to waver. I just wanted to teach you a lesson. I thought a reality check would do you good. I was so sick of your shite, ordering me around and making me do this and that. Shite? You didn't even turn up in costume?
What?
Eric was genuinely puzzled. Behind Ben, skateboard guy and his pals watched in silent fascination, like spectators at a tennis match. It was 80s night, jerk. There was me in a tartan kilt and glitter, and you just turn up in jeans. I felt so stupid. You're always letting me down like that.
Hey, kid.
Zip it. And you want your little blue backpack a crackback? You can't sing for it, because I flushed it.
You didn't.
I did. You should be grateful to me for even bothering. Ben paused, shaking his head bitterly. So many people died this week, and you just go waltzing around the edges of it all, singing a happy little song, carrying on with business as usual. You're lucky you got me to clean up your mess, or you'd probably be in jail by now. I'm the best friend you ever had, and you just treat me like shite, and now I'm sick of it.
Fascinating as this is, I think more pressing business.
I told you to be quiet. Ben's eyes blazed.
Stop it, Ben. You'll get us all into trouble.
I don't care. I just want him to let her go so we can all go home and go to bed and forget all this. That's all I want.
I said I ain't letting her go. Not till you put down that gun and your friend loses the knife.
Not gonna happen, Jerkoff. I'll ask you one more time. Let her go.
Oh, yeah. Or what?
I said I'd shoot you. What, you don't think I will? Skateboard guy sniggered.
I'll be surprised if you do, kid.
Much to his surprise, the kid shot him. Police officer Andy Adams was driving west on Melrose when a call came in on his radio. Andy swore as his partner answered the call, then swung the car around in a tight and completely illegal U-turn, making him spill horseradish sauce down the front of his clean uniform.
Spencer!
Sorry, man. Andy reached for the pack of napkins he kept in the glove compartment, tossing the remains of his hot dog back into its container on the dashboard.
This stuff's worse than goddamn ketchup, he said, dabbing the sauce off his shirt. What's the situation?
We got an 11-6 in the vicinity of Mel's on Sunset.
Meaning?
Officer Spencer sighed. Some idiot left off a gun outside the Hollywood Diner, or possibly a firecracker, we don't know yet.
That place with the giant burgers? Andy licked his lips. Do you think that by any chance we could get...
No, Andy. Spencer reached over and patted Andy's stomach with one hand.
We can't. He picked up his police radio and switched it on.
10-4, he affirmed. Andy looked at his watch. What's cop code for going to lunch now?
That's a code 7, Andy. You should know that one by now. And no, we're not stopping. Don't make me call your wife.
Andy stared gloomily ahead, loosening his seatbelt. Spoil sport.
Jess ducked as a fist swung over her head, then she darted over to the wall where Macy was cowering.
"Come on, get up, we've got to go," she said breathlessly.
Macy was staring at the melee behind her, crouched down against the safety of the wall. Jess turned to follow her gaze. Ben was just visible beneath the two big skinhead guys who were currently trying to remove his arms from their sockets. His gun lay a short distance from him in the middle of the alleyway. Jamie was battling a third attacker, a huge guy in a green army jacket trying to keep him away from the fallen gun. One of the remaining heavies was bending over skateboard guy, who lay at an angle across the curb beneath the scaffolding, clutching at his leg and yelling blue murder. Dark blood was streaming out, staining his trainers red in the moonlight.
"I can't get up! I think he cut through my entire neck! Look, I'm bleeding!" wailed Macy, clutching at her throat with both hands. "Here, let me see."
Jess pulled the girl's trembling hand away from her neck. A tiny line of blood was visible. Jess breathed a sigh of relief.
"You're fine, girl. He just scratched you. You were lucky." "Lucky? I don't call this lucky!"
Macy waved her hand around her miserably.
"Jess, I've got to get out of here. I want to go home."
"I know. It's okay. I'll get you out.
Hey!"
Jess turned around and belted the skinny guy in the black t-shirt, who had just grabbed her by the arm. The man flinched, then yanked sharply on her arm, knocking her off balance and sending her plummeting to the sidewalk.
"Eric!"
Jess yelled, raising her hands above her head, as the guy stalked towards her.
"Get over here!"
"In a minute!"
shouted Eric desperately. He and the remaining tough guy were playing what looked like a game of tag around a nearby parked car, the man chasing him around and round. Eric shrieked like a girl as the man jumped up onto the hood of the car, growling, then leapt onto the roof and down the other side, making a wild grab for him. Eric danced away, sprinted a short distance down the road, then disappeared underneath two powerful-looking guys as they jumped on top of him, hurling him to the ground. He curled up into a ball as they started kicking at him. One of the guys reached down and stripped off his leather jacket, holding it up critically against his chest to check the sizing. As Jess rolled over groggily, Macy hauled herself to her feet and ran over, shoulder barging Jess's attacker with a kamikaze cry. The guy stumbled and Macy pulled off one of her high heels and began systematically beating him over the head with it, shouting, "Get away from her!" Macy hurled her shoe at the man as he ran off. He ducked. There was a fresh howl from skateboard guy as the shoe hit him on the head. Jess took advantage of the reprieve to roll to her feet. She evaluated the situation at a glance. Macy was holding her own, but the three guys seemed to be fighting a losing battle. Eric and Ben were already down on the ground, bleeding profusely, and Jamie wasn't much better off. As she watched, one of the scary-looking skinheads grabbed him in a headlock and headbutted him viciously from behind. His legs buckled and he fell forwards, catching himself on one arm before he hit the ground. He grunted as his attacker kicked him hard in the stomach, muttering a stream of oaths that made even Jess blush. But still, she noted he didn't reach for his knife. Despite the direness of the situation, he went up fractionally in her estimation. Jess stood frozen for a moment, her fist clenched in indecision as she looked around her, trying to decide who to help first. Then a swarthy arm went around her neck, and she was pulled backwards. She immediately slammed both of her elbows back, sinking them into the man's stomach, then kicked backwards with all of her might. Her heel went through empty air as the man neatly sidestepped and yanked her upwards, nearly lifting her clear off the ground. She yelled out and sank her long nails into his arm, then froze as she felt something sharp and cold being pressed against her ribs. An instant later, her attacker gave a cry of pain and released her, turning around to clutch at his back. Jess spun away to see Eric standing behind him, blood pouring from his nose. He was holding a Swiss Army penknife, the twisty bottle opener attachment open and coated in blood.
"Yeah!" he whooped. "Who's your daddy now?"
He gave a shout of triumph, then hastily ducked as a huge fist swung at his head. Jess grabbed the man's other arm and tried to pull him away from Eric, then jumped as a blinding blue light filled her vision.
"What the?"
Jess looked around her, puzzled, then flinched as the blue light flashed again, leaving a black and purple afterglow on the inside of her eyelids. She shook her head to clear it, staring around in confusion. A wave of dizziness hit her, and she went spinning to the floor as the thug shook her off his arm.
Jess hit the ground hard, only just bringing her hands up in time to stop her head from smashing on the sidewalk. She lay still for a beat, dazed, her hands stinging. Then she gasped as a barrage of images filled her mind, overlaid on the street scene before her. She saw bright lights, neon signs, the flash of passing traffic. A blur of streets zoomed past at high speed, then buildings, squat, gray, ugly, familiar-looking. A white street sign zoomed forwards, quickly blurring out of focus before she could read it, then vanished and was replaced by another, then another. Palm trees swayed crazily behind them in the nighttime wind, and the moon blazed down with the intensity of a nuclear furnace, bathing her in its cold white light. Then she was indoors, running down a brightly lit corridor. Footsteps pounded behind her, and she increased her pace. She frantically scanned the nameplates above the doors, driven by a great sense of urgency. Door after door swung open in front of her, and her panic increased as she neared the end of the corridor, fear filling her in a rising tide. As she ran, she heard voices, muted and far away, as though they were coming to her down a long metal tube.
"Someone help me! I think that they got Jess! Why, she's just lying there! Get her up! Oh, crap! Look out!"
Jess blinked and looked up to see Macy crouched over her, shaking her urgently. Then someone grabbed her, pulling Macy away from her. Confused, Jess struck out blindly as she was dragged along the ground, her mind filled with jumping images as her vision cut back and forth between the alley and the corridor. Then she cried out in pain as her head struck a brick wall. Black static filled her mind, and she felt strong fingers ripping at her clothing. And then the blue fire washed over her again, silencing the voices. Her vision flashed with gray, then jump cut back again to the corridor as the end wall sped towards her. With a flash of darkness, she was suddenly on the other side of the wall, moving across the room at great speed. The room was freezing, and dozens of mice darted across the floor beneath her feet, scampering away from her in panic. Slowing down, she looked about the room. There were dozens of hospital-style gurneys set up in long rows down the sides of the room, the green sheets covering them stained with blood. They were all empty, apart from one. Jess's nerves screamed at her as she felt herself being drawn towards the gurney, as though she were magnetized. There was a body on it covered in a similar green sheet. There was no blood on it, but somehow, that was even more terrifying. Jess knew that whoever was under there was important, but also knew that she wasn't brave enough to look. Beneath her, millions of mice swarmed around underfoot, hopping and jumping over her feet, and clambering up the legs of the gurney, squeaking excitedly. Moonlight shone in through the window, bathing the scene in a pale light. As she stood there, a sharp wind blew through the room, raising dust and making reams of paperwork fly about. She turned around to see the door fly open, but nobody came in. Perhaps it had just been blown open by the storm, the one that was gathering outside? She fearfully turned back to the gurney and gasped. The sheet had been blown off. She stared at the person lying on the gurney. No, it couldn't be. But it was. Jess gazed down at the body and felt a single tear trickle down her cheek. It was her mother. With a cry, Jess started backing rapidly away, but found herself held tight by some invisible force. She couldn't move. She struck out with a cry and heard someone nearby yell in pain. She blinked as the body vanished and was replaced by a broken guitar, its neck snapped and the strings hanging loosely down onto the floor. Blood was oozing out of the gaps around the pickups. Jess backed away, then whirled around and began running. She suddenly knew what had happened to her mother. But it wasn't her fault. It really wasn't. She flew down the corridor and reached the main doors to the building. But try as she might, she couldn't open them. She hammered on the door with all of her strength and was surprised as they suddenly blew open, revealing a world filled with blinding bright light. Jess squinted into the glare, just able to make out the shapes of people running towards her. There was a loud bang and a scream and the whoop of a police siren. She turned to run, then cracking blue lights exploded on the inside of her retina, and her mind filled with pain. Then she was falling, falling, falling. Jess jerked her head up from the sidewalk with a gasp. She was back in the alley again, this time, propped up awkwardly against a wall. Eric was bending over her, shaking her much harder than was necessary. Her head hurt, and she could taste blood in her mouth. Jess blinked. Her sweater was torn, and she could feel the rising wind gusting through it. She reached down in confusion to touch the rip.
"Get off me! What happened?" she said indistinctly.
A flurry of movement came from nearby. Jess looked over to see Jamie pinning down the guy who'd grabbed her. The man was struggling wildly and growling threats at him as Jamie punched him in the face. Macy gave a shriek, held between two of the skinheads. Ben was lying on the ground nearby, groaning weakly. In the far distance came the sound of that police siren.
"You passed out," said Eric. "You must have hit your head. I..."
"Eric..."
Jess seized his shirt, suddenly wide awake.
"I have to go to the morgue right now."
Eric looked down at her.
"Geez, girl, you only bumped your head. It's not that bad."
"No, it's my mother."
Eric looked at her in confusion, one eyebrow raised.
"I think she's dead," Jess managed.
"What?"
"The club. I think she was at the club."
Jess felt tears well up in her eyes.
"I'm always nagging her to come see me play, but she never shows. This one time, I think she did, and..."
Jess took a deep breath, steadying herself. She had to focus if she was going to get through this.
"I have to go look for her at the morgue. Dad said she hasn't been home in days. If she was at the club, that's where she'll be."
"Well, that sucks," said Eric, trying to look sympathetic and failing dismally. "We'll go there after we've finished up here."
He waved a hand at the brawl in front of them. "Hopefully not in body bags," he added to himself.
"We have to stop this. I need to go. This is crazy."
Jess's voice tailed off as she noticed something lying on the sidewalk just a few yards from her. It was the fallen gun. Scrambling to her feet, Jess ran towards it, darting around the various struggling figures. Reaching the sidewalk, she dived forwards and made a grab for it, but she was too late. A blood-stained hand snaked forwards and snatched it from under her nose, whipping it away before Jess could stop him. She heard the sound of a trigger being cocked back.
"Ben, no!" cried Jess.
"I told you to let her go."
Ben staggered to his feet and stood there swaying. The two tough guys holding Jess shoved her in front of them like a human shield. They started laughing.
"Ben, don't!"
There was an ear-splitting bang that seemed to physically drive the air out of her eardrums. Jess reflexively shut her eyes and slapped her hands over her ears in pain. A high-pitched ringing noise filled her head. She felt as if someone had just kicked her directly in the brain. She was vaguely aware of the sounds of yelling and running, and then everyone went quiet. Cautiously, she removed her hands from her head and opened her eyes.
"Ben?"
she said, looking around her. Everything sounded muffled as though her ears were full of cotton. She saw Ben. He was staring straight forwards, his hands hanging loosely at his sides. The gun was lying on the ground in front of him. She heard a sharp intake of breath from behind her. Slowly, Jess turned around. Macy was cowering against the wooden boarding by the wall, her hands over her head, her eyes screwed tight shut. There was no one else around. Her heart hammering, Jess peered closer. Macy was unharmed. Jess let out her breath explosively, and she relaxed, a ferocious hope rising inside her. They'd made it. Macy was alive. If she could make it, then maybe there was hope for the rest of them. Maybe, just maybe, fate could be beaten. There was a cry from over on the sidewalk. Jess glanced over her shoulder to see Jamie bending over the skinny skateboard guy, pressing a folded sweater over the man's leg wound.
"Someone call an ambulance," he yelled.
Eric dropped his hand onto Jess's shoulder, making her jump.
"Jesus H. Christ," he breathed in her ear. "That was close."
"You don't say," said Jess.
She stared at Ben.
"Did he? Where did..."
"He missed," said Eric. "Scared the shit out of those guys, though."
He reached up and wiped the blood from his nose.
"And me."
He stepped forward and picked up the gun, clicking the safety catch back on and tucking it into his jeans. Then he reached out and carefully patted Ben on the shoulder, as though he were a small child who'd just dropped his ice cream. Ben turned around and stared at him, his face completely drained of blood.
"He always was a crap shot, weren't you, Benny boy? I always beat the hell out of him at time crisis. Do you have a tissue?"
"Here."
Jess reached into her pocket and handed him one. There were more important things to sort out.
"Macy," she said.
Macy unfroze and took a timid step forwards.
"Can I go home now?"
she asked, her eyes huge.
"Sure."
Jess gave Ben a hard glare. He noticed her presence for the first time and started guiltily staring at her. Seeing the expression on her face, he dropped his gaze to the ground, hanging his head. The sound of police sirens were getting louder. Jess waved her hand dismissively towards the noise.
"We'll just tell them that we were attacked," she said, nodding at the fallen skateboard guy. "It's our word against his about who the gun originally belonged to."
Turning, Jess started walking over to Macy.
"Come on, girl. Let's get you."
A huge metal panel dropped down from high up on the scaffolding. Before any of them could react, it landed edge first on Macy's shoulder, cleanly slicing her into two bloody halves. Jess blinked. After what seemed like an age, Macy's body collapsed onto the ground, like so much meat dropped from a butcher's van. Her remains didn't even twitch. Jess shut her eyes tight, then opened them again and looked at Macy. There were so many organs inside the human body. Jess knew that because she could see most of them now. She stared, mesmerized. Jamie ran over and skidded to a halt beside them. The three of them stood and stared at what, until 5 seconds ago, had been a living, breathing human being. Blood gushed out of Macy's hacked open body, rolling away into the gutter in a bright wave. Inside her truncated ribcage, things glistened. Eric looked down at his t-shirt. It was covered in splatters of blood. So much for the damn laundry, he thought with a touch of hysteria. Numbly, he reached into his pocket for his cell phone, then dialed 911. Tearing her gaze away from the ruined corpse, Jess's eyes numbly tracked up the scaffolding to the second floor of the building, where the panel had dropped from only moments before. A wooden beam hung limply from that scaffold, swinging back and forth. It was still attached at one end, she saw, where some kind of brace had obviously given way. But why, she wondered. Jess looked down at the metal panel lying beside the remains of Macy's dead body. In one corner, by a torn-out bolt, there was a very small, very incriminating bullet hole.
Okay, Slashaholics, that was the very intense, very action-packed, very epic Chapter 12 of Final Destination Dead Reckoning. Whew, what a chapter. I gotta say, guys, I did not see this part of the story coming. Like, I didn't know exactly where it was gonna go, because it only had like 60 pages left, which there's only one upload left, guys. Tomorrow's upload will be the final upload of this book. It'll be the end of it. That's how close we are to the ending. That's why this whole scene threw me off, because I did not expect it to go here. You know, I didn't expect there to be like this big old fight with a gang in a dark alleyway, you know, but man, was that freaking crazy, right? And it sucks that Ben is the cause of Macy's death. That's hardcore. And I'm looking forward to the last upload tomorrow to find out everybody's reaction to that, because Jess knows it. She just saw the bullet hole, so she knows that's what caused it. And I'm sure Ben is seeing it too, or is about to.
But yeah, wow, guys, there's not much I can say about tonight's chapter other than, wow, great action, great scenes, great character development, that awesome, crazy vision that Jess was having. Wow, really hardcore. It felt like her subconscious was trying to fill in some blanks for her that she wasn't even aware of. So, yeah, guys, let me know what you thought of tonight's upload, and I'll be back tomorrow with the conclusion of Final Destination Dead Reckoning. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying thanks for listening, and
I'll see you soon. There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Darker.